Ladies and gentlemen, thanks very much for that introduction. It's a joy and a pleasure to be with you. I find the subject of live cattle and livestock exports to be tremendously attractive because I find that cattle don't disagree with me on the whole, and you can read them copies of The Australian and they pay attention. Now, for the next 20 minutes or so, I recall the words of American politician Adlai Stevenson in a circumstance like this. For the next 20 minutes or so, it's my job to talk, it's your job to listen. If you should finish your job before I finish my job, no hard feelings whatsoever. And I understand this is a serious, hard-headed business conference. Therefore, it's important that you have one irresponsible, sensationalist, yellow press tabloid exaggerator in your midst, and I'll do my best for you. So I have a nice narrow topic to talk about, Australia and Asia. Easy to cover that comprehensively in 20 minutes, no problems really. I thought, and our chairman told me last night that above all I had to be blunt and straightforward with you folks, that I wasn't addressing an audience of diplomats where, you know, when you deliver an insult, you do it so sweetly that the person thinks they're being flattered, and when you deliver flattery, it's really secretly an insult, that it was better to be very direct with you. So I am going to identify a few big trends that I think are evident in Asia and which are going to affect Australia's trade with Asia and indeed probably your businesses with Asia, and just draw those out a little bit for you. The first is that all across Asia, you are seeing a very resurgent sense of nationalism. This is occurring all over the world, but it's certainly occurring in Asia. So the old ideas of pooling sovereignty, of enhanced international cooperation, still going to get plenty of international cooperation, but each nation is defined in its politics and its policies by an increasing rise of nationalism. You see that most obviously in Xi Jinping in China, but you also see it in Narendra Modi in India, in Shinzo Abe in Japan, in the interplay of the generals and the monarchy in Thailand. You see it certainly in Indonesia, where one element of nationalism concerns your industry very directly, and that is the rhetoric and desire for food self-security within Indonesia, which is linked more even than, or food self-sufficiency rather, which is linked in the Indonesian mind more with a nationalist sentiment than it is linked with any real concern about not having enough food to feed the population. So nationalism, I think, is coming to dominate Asian politics in both democratic societies and undemocratic societies. And that is leading to the second big trend I'd identify, which is nationalist economic policy. Everyone is an America First person now. As Donald Trump said at APEC, he puts America first and he expects all of Asia's leaders to put their countries first. Now, of course, that has always been the way it is. But there was a period of 20 or 30 years where politeness forbade leaders from saying explicitly that. Now they do say explicitly that. That doesn't mean nations can't cooperate, but it means the transactionalism of international arrangements is more naked than it's ever been before. And the sort of folderol of good international citizenship and the like counts for even less than it used to count. But on the other hand, in the old days, I once asked a very senior Australian official what that sort of good international citizenship counted for, and he said to me, well, you know, that and a couple of dollars will buy you a cup of coffee in most parts of the world. So it doesn't really indicate a big change. It's more that something is obvious and naked and clear now that wasn't so clear before. The third big trend, I think, which is related to the first two, is an increased challenge to all aspects of globalisation. People are not willing to sign up to the ideology or the ideas of globalization anymore. Davos man is dead. Davos will continue because you can't kill these institutions. It's like the Commonwealth, you know. It has no reason to exist. It is literally a dead man walking, but it will continue to walk in perpetuity, forever, a ghostly shade upon the international stage. The same is true of the Davos Economic Forums. You know, they are sublimely irrelevant, completely useless, utterly without merit of any kind, but they will go on forever and ever and ever. But anyone who is silly enough to think that Davos, the spirit of Davos, infuses the world or infuses Asia is just not living in the real world. And the fourth trend in Asia that I'd like to identify for you is a retreat of democracy and liberalisation. That's not a trend I'm happy about, but it's my job to tell you the truth, not to gild the lily for you. I was a correspondent in China way back in 1985. I was the first ever correspondent that my paper ever sent to China. And in those days, China was much, on the whole, less liberal probably than it is today. Certainly it was much less developed. You didn't see many cars in the street. You saw rivers of bicycles. Lots of men still wore Mao suits and so on. But there was an optimism about the liberal project within China. There was a sense that they'd only just begun the liberalisation journey, but that it had no end point. It could just go on forever and ever. Sir Peter Abels, a very fine Australian, a very fine businessman, a man for whom I have great respect, nonetheless, you know, made a remark which encapsulated the spirit of the age and also the silliness of the age when he told the Australian Press Corps at a press conference once that China would eventually become more liberal than Australia. This was a foolish comment to make in 1985, but it's almost laughably foolish now. But that was the sentiment back then. Liberalisation in China has gone into reverse, and you've seen increased authoritarianism. We've seen democracy suspended in Thailand as the military rules. We've seen the election of a very tough or autocratic president in the Philippines. We've seen the definitive end and reversal of liberalisation trends in Vietnam and in Cambodia. There was a little while, not long after the Australian-sponsored peace process in Cambodia, when there were semi-credible elections in Cambodia. That's all gone. So the big triumph for democracy in Asia is Indonesia, or for new democracy. India is the other great triumph for democracy, but Indonesia is the triumph for new democracy. Their democracy is holding, but at the same time, illiberal trends are emerging as well, as we saw with the jailing of the governor of Jakarta, Ahok, for misrepresented and mistranslated comments that he made of a most inoffensive nature, that the Quran didn't prevent people voting for non-Muslims as political leaders. He's now in jail as a result of a statement as mild as that. So that's another big trend to be aware of. And the idea which my friend, whom I esteem immensely, Gareth Evans, when he used to be Prime Minister, talked about once, of convergence in political values between Australia and Asia, is complete bonkers now. You couldn't possibly argue that. We've just endorsed same-sex marriage. Good luck if you're going to sell that one in Indonesia. And the idea that we are somehow on a convergent path politically and culturally is crackers. Now, that doesn't lead us to engage less with Asia, but we've got to engage realistically. Now, there's another big factor in Asia that I draw your attention to, which is that the two biggest players have a great deal of uncertainty surrounding them. The biggest, most powerful leader in Asia, of course, is Donald Trump. The most powerful nation in Asia is the United States of America. Any Australian who doesn't realise that doesn't understand anything at all about Asia. The central reality of Asia since World War II and perhaps for the last 100 years has been American power, and it's going to continue to be the central reality of Asia. But nobody can understand what Trump's Asia policy is, perhaps least of all Trump himself. We don't know whether Asia policy is his crazy tweets or it is the sober, sensible statements of his Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson, his Secretary of Defense, Jim Mattis, his National Security Advisor, McMaster, his Chief of Staff, Kelly, all very, very good people, much better than the people they replaced in the Obama administration. But you don't know whether they represent the reality of Trump policy or Trump's crazy tweets represent the reality of Trump policy. We don't know whether Trump is going to lurch into some protectionist trade agenda. He said he would as a candidate. He's been elected now for 12 months and he hasn't done it. So does that mean he never really meant to do it, but it was always a bluff and a negotiating technique? Or does it mean he's so incompetent that he can't get it through his own system and he's going to come back at it later? Your guess is as good as mine. But I would suggest to you that there is an equal level of uncertainty about China's leader, Xi Jinping. Now, China's leader, Xi Jinping, has quite a lot of similarities to Trump. They're both arch nationalists. They're both portly sons of privilege. They both grew up in gilded cages within their respective societies. They are both utterly ruthless, and they are both destroying the institutionalism which they have inherited. In China, after the Cultural Revolution, there was a tremendous desire to move away from one-man rule. So you got the convention that the posts would be divided, party general secretary, president of the state, chairman of the military commission, and so on, all made into different posts. There would be a collective leadership in the Politburo and the Standing Committee, and that no president could have more than two terms. At the same time, whenever you talk to the Chinese about human rights or anything like that, they'd talk to you about their developing legal system. And whenever you talk to them about trade, they'd talk to you about their developing legal system. Xi has reversed all that. He's thrown all that out the window. The institutionalism has been swept away. The Politburo Standing Committee has been reduced in size and reduced in status to a rubber stamp. He has taken all the posts himself, not quite as bad as Kim Jong-un, but moving in that direction. He's known, the great sinologist Jeremy Barmey calls him the COE of China, the chairman of everything. He runs all the policy committees. There is a cult of personality which the state is erecting around Xi Jinping. Now, at the moment, Xi's policy choices have all been rational. Some of them have been very aggressive, such as militarizing the South China Sea, and China has continued with its astonishing cyber espionage and theft of intellectual property and so on. But at the same time, it has stayed within the forms of international organizations. But the reason I say there's equal uncertainty about Xi as there is about Trump is that one-man rule is inherently very unstable. If that one man goes a bit crook or loses his judgment, there's nothing to stop very bad decisions. We don't know the limit of Xi's strategic ambition in the South China Sea. We don't know how he's going to react in trade policy down the track. And he's had disputes with all of his neighbours and all the nations of Southeast Asia, even as he's seduced them, even as Chinese money has been so powerful. So there's tremendous uncertainty within Asia about the two big players, Trump and Xi Jinping. Oddly enough, we have much more certainty about the other three big players. Shinzo Abe in Japan has been a model of stability, and Japanese policy has been incremental and very predictable and very effective with Trump. Narendra Modi has been an effective economic reformer in India. And of course, India has the stability of a democracy. The paradox always is that a dictatorship often looks stable at the surface, but underneath it's very brittle, whereas a democracy looks brittle at the surface because all the politicians are bickering all the time, but underneath its structures are very stable because its government always has the legitimacy of elections. Modi is a very effective prime minister, nationalist but democratic, and the Indian economy is motoring along and will for a long time be the fastest growing substantial economy in the world. And the third leader, who is looking stronger all the time, is our own neighbour and friend, Jokowi in Indonesia. He has recovered his political position, after a lot of difficulty a year or 18 months ago, he has reasserted his leadership in the parliament. His poll ratings are very good. He's looking very hard to beat in the next presidential election. And he has been pretty tough on Islamist extremists. He's outlawed Hizbut Tahrir, something we're not willing to do in this country. The head of the Islamic Defenders Front is cowering in Saudi Arabia, not game to return to Indonesia. The guy, although Ahok, the former governor of Jakarta, is in jail, which is a tremendous travesty, the guy who first made the fake video misrepresenting Ahok's remarks is also in jail. And Jokowi is strong in Indonesia. However, Indonesian policy is a bit hard to calibrate. At the same time, they'll talk a good talk about free trade, but Jokowi himself, among many others, talks about food self-sufficiency, which is the opposite of free trade. He's made pretty good progress on infrastructure. The economy is bowling along at about 5% annual growth. You'd like it to be higher. Indonesia has the potential for it to be higher. You'd always hope that it would get up to the 7 or 8%. But 5% is pretty much about a pass mark, and it's consistent with democratic growth, democratic stability. And if Jokowi is re-elected next time, that will be a very solid outcome for Indonesia, to move from generals to civilians, to have time after time after time of the democratic transfer of power through elections. So I think we can look well on Indonesia. I think Australia has a lot more to do in its policies towards Asia. I almost don't like to say words like its policies towards Asia, because Asia is such an amorphous concept. Even when we think of Asia, I think we should always have three huge sub-regions in mind that are quite separate. South Asia, which is India, Northeast Asia, which is China, Japan and Korea, and Southeast Asia. And Australians have largely forgotten about Southeast Asia, except for Indonesia. I can remember covering the 1992 election, presidential election in the Philippines, where Fidel Ramos, fantastic guy, was elected president, was front page news in Australia. The last presidential election in the Philippines hardly got any coverage in Australia at all. It's very hard for us as a society to have good policy towards regions of Asia, of which we are spectacularly illiterate. Now, let me give you two examples of our policy to Indonesia, one which was tremendously destructive and one which was tremendously constructive. The most destructive thing we've done with Indonesia in the last decade, probably more than a decade, was the sudden and astonishing suspension of the live cattle export trade. I mean, it did quite a lot of damage to Australia and no doubt to you folks, but it was very damaging to Australia's reputation in Indonesia. We'd been telling the Indonesians for decades and for longer, put your faith in free trade. When you've got a contract, it's reliable. You don't need to own all the production facilities, all the stock that you're going to use, because you can rely on trade. You can buy the things as customers, and that's how the international economy flourishes. You produce one thing and sell it with your comparative advantage. We produce another thing and sell it with our comparative advantage. And in a moment, we destroyed all of that message, and we even threatened temporarily food security for maybe a quarter of the population. It is, I think, with the exception of the complications around East Timor, the single most destructive episode I've ever seen in the Australia-Indonesia relationship. And it came from a political culture in Australia which did not value the Indonesia relationship highly enough to make it a priority, much less valuing our own industry high enough. Here's an example, a counterexample now, of a good policy towards Indonesia. You know, when Tony Abbott said he would turn back the boats, nobody thought he could do it, including me. And I said to him, we were having a drink in Melbourne, and I said to him at one point, shortly after he'd become Prime Minister, mate, you know, I don't think you can really turn back the boats. Labor's offshore processing has reduced the numbers. That's as much as you can do. If you try to turn back a boat, somebody will drown, there'll be a crisis, the Indonesians will go bananas. And he said, ah, well, mate, I've got a cunning plan. And I thought, oh, geez, this is terrible. And look what happened. He did have a cunning plan, and it worked. The Indonesians complained about it. Nobody died. The boats were turned back. The boats stopped as a result. And a few months later, I was interviewing President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, and he said to me in the interview, we are very glad that the boats have stopped. We don't have to respond to it as an issue now. And his staff, I had lunch with his staff straight after the interview, and they said, look, we can never support Abbott's policy publicly, but we're delighted with the outcome. The boats have stopped, which means it's not an issue. It never gets into our media, which means we don't have to respond to it. But not only that, the incentive for all the people to come to Indonesia in order to travel onto Australia has stopped. So that segment of people who were coming to Indonesia just to come to Australia has stopped. Of course, they had to criticise Australian policy publicly, but the long-term consequence of that policy was that we removed a massive structural irritant in relations between Australia and Indonesia, and it's never been a problem ever since. And as a result, Malcolm Turnbull and Jokowi could have their love fest and become best buddies with their mutual love of gadgets and everything, and there was nothing to bugger that up. Now, I'll just finish with the reflection that I think as an industry and as individuals, you, like all Australians, have a right to ask the government not to bugger things up for you. That's the very bare minimum that you have a right to ask. On the whole, although I'm very critical of that live cattle trade suspension, on the whole, I think governments of both parties have been pretty good in their Asia policy, pretty good. They've stuck fast to the American alliance, which is one of our great assets in Asia. They've pursued engagement, commercial, cultural, political, as much as they can. They have certainly made a priority of Indonesia and of China. They're very slow to wake up to India, and I think we've fallen behind a bit in the rest of Southeast Asia. But overall, you know, they're only politicians, and I'd give them kind of somewhere between a B minus and a B plus, which for a journalist is extraordinarily generous. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Greg. And Greg and I had a conversation last night as he was heading out of the room, and I asked him to do exactly what he's done now. So I'm really pleased about that. It was exactly what we needed to hear, I think, Greg. So, questions, if anybody has them. Oh, there we go. Sorry, right at the back of the room there. Yeah.
Thanks. Greg, Colin Bettles from Fairfax Media. Given your criticism of the government's decision to close the live cattle trade to Indonesia, which way do you think the court should go in its claim against the Commonwealth in terms of malfeasance in relation to that decision?
Look, I'd have to say that in my entire life, speaking to a conference and being asked a question by a fellow journalist is utterly astounding. And I am generally very happy to give advice to everybody, including the courts. And I've always followed the long journalistic dictum that you never should let the fact that you don't know much about a subject prevent you from having a strong opinion about it. However, although I'm very politically critical of that decision, I'm very, very critical of it, and I was very critical of it at the time, I'd have to tell you I don't know enough about the court case. So I apologise. I'm going to weasel out just as though I were a politician, avoiding offending a critical constituency. And of course, the other thing is, you just do have to be occasionally a bit careful of contempt of court considerations as well. But there you go. I apologise. I raise the white flag. Fairfax has trumped News Corporation. Let it be said.
That's a great answer, Greg. You're happy? You're happy, Cole? Another question there. Yes.
Hi, Kim Haywood, WA Farmers Federation. Be really interested to get your views on foreign ownership and purchase of businesses in Australia.
This is a really interesting question, and it's a really interesting question. At many, many levels, I think the sale of the Port of Darwin was a shocking blunder by the current government, a shocking blunder. And it spoke to very poor processes, ill thought through, and poorly coordinated. However, it did lead to reform of those processes. So now all critical infrastructure, which may have a national security dimension, goes through a proper consideration. We had to reform the Foreign Investment Review Board somewhat to put David Irvin, a very, very distinguished Australian public servant, former head of ASIO and former ambassador to China, on the Foreign Investment Review Board. I still don't think we've got our processes altogether right. Now, I must say I have two contradictory impulses when I respond to that question. Partly, I'm a well-trained foreign editor with globalist free trade instincts saying, well, if any foreigner is silly enough to want to buy something that I own for more than it's really worth, God bless him, you know, and if ever I auction my house, I want as many foreign buyers as possible on the lawn, you know, I'll serve them everything, dim sums, curry, anything to get them. I want their money. On the other hand, I am uneasy about too many strategic assets going into foreign hands. There are different foreign hands from different foreign hands. You know, we used to distinguish Chinese state-owned enterprises from Chinese private enterprises. One of the consequences of Xi Jinping is that that distinction no longer matters. Xi has now decreed that there will be a Communist Party cell at the center of the management of every Chinese company, private or state-owned enterprise. So if there is a national security dimension, it doesn't really matter whether it's a state-owned enterprise or a private Chinese enterprise. But of course, most assets don't have a national security dimension. I don't know. I no longer really believe in the pure theology of free trade. I've had a crisis of faith. I'm an apostate, really. I'm not a complete heathen. I haven't become an out-and-out protectionist. I now sit in that middle school of agnostic uncertainty, happy to evaluate each proposition on its merits and look at the general trend, suck it and see. And we still approve overall the vast majority of foreign purchases. So I don't think you can argue that the pendulum has swung too far back in favour of closing things down. It is, of course, the truth that there is no Asian nation which is as open as us. I mean, try and invest in the Chinese equivalent of NBN. Go and try and buy the port of Shanghai if you're an American state-owned enterprise and see how you go. So we shouldn't feel any ethical pressure of reciprocity or anything like that. I think it's pragmatic, it's case by case. Politicians need to justify it to the electorate where there are clear benefits, you know, where the new owner can run business better than the old Australian owner, fair enough. I wish we didn't make it so hard for businesses in Australia to flourish themselves. It would be better if our businesses flourished than if they had to be sold to foreigners in order to flourish. I don't like weird side deals, you know, if the foreign owner can bring in a foreign workforce and all that. But so I think I'm about where the electorate is. Not against foreign sales, but uneasy and wanting each big project justified on its merits.